in Missouri, and also the place of the largest recorded earthquake in North America in 1811 and 1812. We are here at the New Madrid Historical Museum. Let's go check it out.
Located on Highway 61, about 3 miles west of New Madrid. Mounds of this type are typical of the Mississippian Indians, who are often referred to as the mound builders. Many remnants of the Mississippian culture were found at a site excavated by Dr. Carl Chapman of the University of Missouri, and are on display in the museum. Found at the site was this partially cremated skeleton, thought to be an important chief or priest, identified by the presence of this rare stone base. In 1539, the Spanish explorer, Hernando de Soto, led an expedition from Florida into the interior of the continent. In 1541, he discovered and crossed the Mississippi River, just below present-day Memphis, Tennessee. Tradition has it that de Soto held the first religious ceremony here. It would be another 132 years before any explorers reached the New Madrid area of the continent. The Mississippi River came to mark the dividing line and territorial claims on the American continent by various European powers. For that reason, the flag of Great Britain has never flown west of the river. 2 years after the end of the American Revolution, the first settlement was established near present-day New Madrid. In 1783, two brothers, Francois and Joseph Le Sœur from St. Louis, established a post for the purpose of trading furs with local Indians and travelers. Dr. Morgan grew discouraged about his ambitious project and went back to Philadelphia, his home. The Spanish then took over the settlement and erected Fort Celeste. This early map of New Madrid shows the location of the Spanish fort. In 1803, the United States purchased the Louisiana Territory. This map, dated 1810, shows the outlay of the town just 7 years afterwards, 1864. New Madrid was important to both North and South during the Civil War because of its strategic position on the river. A more important military point lay 6 miles upriver, which was known as a riverman at bottom number 10. In March 1862, Union Brigadier General John Pope was given the task of driving the Confederates from New Madrid to hand on them number 10. After taking the city, General Pope planned to recapture Island Number 10 upriver from New Madrid. The Union General formulated an ingenious plan. Cutting the mouth to bypass the Confederates, the riverman first crossed the normal town. By the end of the Civil War, the city laid out by Colonel William
Stokely,
their houses and businesses. Shelter in what buildings were still standing, or making do with what shelter was available, and away they thought.
Boston were left homeless again when the new tremors destroyed almost less of the buildings. But as the smaller tremors continued, people became accustomed to them, and life returned to business as usual as the shocks gradually subsided. The farmers, returning to their fields, found many changes in the landscape they had worked so diligently to raise crops on. The earthquake and following aftershocks caused a phenomenon known as sand blows, or sand boils, by a river full of uprooted trees. One woman, terrified by the event, ran for safety, finally died of fear and exhaustion. Every house in the town of 800 persons was down, but only a few other fatalities were reported because the area was sparsely settled. In 1811, there were no news channels, no newspaper photographers, no satellites to report live on the scene action. In fact, few scientifically trained individuals were in the United States, much less in the primitive region around New Madrid during the earthquakes. Instead, verbal reports from untrained observers were collected by reporters or newspapers, and inhabitants wrote to eyewitness accounts about their experiences, often in letters to faraway relatives. Scholars and